There is a factory whose outlines fall within the purview of my eye, whose tall walls and towering smokestacks give it a peculiar configuration of grimness and beauty. It is a manufacturing plant, devoted to the labor of turning out cotton sheeting, and within whose walls labor some hundreds of human beings whose sole recommendation in the eyes of society is that they can tend a machine. If you were to watch this factory at early morning, you would observe a great plume of smoke curling majestically upward about the hours of 6:30, when the engineer first comes to make his boilers ready for the day. At 7, when a long line of more or less discouraged or indifferent people are filing in, you would hear the clarion call of its whistle rising like a great cry, which means labor. Thereafter, until noon, and again during the afternoon, you would hear the thrash and rumble of this machinery, roaring like a torrent over great rocks, a sound not unlike that which you may hear at Niagara, or could before that current was displaced. The interior of this factory presents a scene for which the world has long waited in art, and for which the talents of the genius is reserved. It is a long, darksome chamber, set with high, small-panned, prison-like windows, whose mass of light falls like a radiance of evening over the interior. The floors are set with long, evenly arranged rows of clanking machines, whose thrashing shuttles and whirring bobbins make up a roar that is deafening to the ear. Solemn, impressive shadows of men and women go about among them, principally women and some children, whose appearance stamps them as a lesser order of being, the kind, shall we say, who are made to work. They are wonderfully constructed, these chattering, intelligent, almost human machines. They do deftly and swiftly what hundreds of keen-eyed men could not. They know when one of their 300 threads are broken, and stop. They know when the tiny cord is fastened again, and go on. They revolve a number of hundreds of times to the minute, carry 300 spindles, thin out cards of cotton to gossamer threads, and toss a shuttle to and fro millions of times a day. The one great engine, somewhere down in the shadow of the basement, drives them all. These chambers, wherein they revolve, are gray, even in Haken weather. Outside, the earth may be flooded with sunshine, the flowers blooming, the trees stirred by cooling breezes. Inside is dust, shadow, the odor of oil, and this deafening roar that never ends. Men move about silently. The women of the machine shuffle listlessly to and fro, occasionally fixing something. Dust and oil are in the air. Dust is on the floor, which is black and shiny with oil. Dust is upon the walls, which are streaked and splattered with it, and oil in combination. Dust is upon the ceiling, which is stuccoed with oil-impregnated motes of cotton. You could not move anywhere and not come in contact with it, except in the case of the soft white blankets of cotton, which are bundled about here and there, cotton as white as snow. It is not so much the factory as the people in it with whom we are concerned. I don't know how you feel about life, but these people strike me as having a woefully sad end of it. They are such poor, slovenly-looking creatures. Their minds are apparently so hopelessly inadequate to the task of living well. You see them bound about here, some stout, but wholly colorless in the face. Some lean, but so angularly bony and frail withal as to be pitiful. Dark, colorful, liquid eyes meet yours, filled with a low, inadequate fire. They run these machines, these people, driven by some sense of duty or some force of want, or because parents make them, strange reasons when you know how dutyless and indifferent some portions of the remaining world really are. And this labor, it is so impressively commonplace when you examine it. There is so little of real thought involved, so much less of real, joyful exercise. They may not truly stretch their muscles and make them good and tense all day long. They may not use their minds for one swift fancy in the same period. All is watching, a silent cat-like watching, which is neither through nor strength, but a constant creeping to and fro, reaching here, bending over there, testing a thread, pulling in a new spindle. A weak woman can take care of 3, another 5, another 7 machines. An ordinary man could handle as many as 9 or 10. It all depends on one's ability to see and move fairly quickly, not swiftly at all. It matters not if the fingers are white and lean, no difference if the body is frail, the lungs may be weak, the body wretched, if the eyes are good and the fingers are nimble, all else will follow as a matter of course. It seems at times as if there were a silent waiting and watching, for nothing. And yet, these people are human beings. You see them hurrying away at night with an eagerness that suggests great possibility in the way of desire. The streets which they occupy, the cities which they infest, run with a wild current of excitement at night, as if the weariness and meanness of the day were being compensated for at night by a riotous abandon. The search of the soul for something wherewith to satisfy its existence, to compensate itself for being alive. I sometimes look at this factory in the glow of the evening sun, or through the pleasing drizzle of a rainy day, and ponder over the philosophy of it. Its stature is so graceful, its tall chimney so artistic. If you view it as a picture solely, it is one of those satisfying anomalies which the heart of man greatly rejoices in. The color of its walls is so adequate, the height of its form of its chimney so wholly pleasing and ornate. Seen through the glow of the setting sun, or when the rain or fog are softening it to a mere shadowy outline, it appears a sweet concoction of nature, like a flower or a tree. The beauty of it makes it agreeable to that idea. And yet we know how homely it really is, how wretched to some minds. There are hearts there too, no doubt, that despite its very walls, like the prisoner does to its prison, to them it is toil, weariness, wretchedness, privation. They see nothing but the grime and the hurt. We, who are not of it, may witness the sweetness and beauty which they will never know. How will we adjust this anomaly, say you? How will we give each his due? By realizing sometimes, I think, that a portion of work should fall to us all, and by seeing that this portion is never stinted, we should not take from our neighbor that which he should justly have, nor withhold that which he may enjoy, never to reap where we do not sow, nor idle where we have not labored. I know this is an old ideal. I know that despite its wonderment or pity, the world smiles complacently. Life will take care of itself. The world cannot be bettered by theory. Perhaps not. The problem of the factory, however, is here before us. May we adjust to it according to the highest dictates of our soul. Theodore Dreiser, 1910.